Welcome to the ACG interview series. This is going to be the last one for the year to wrap it up. And this is actually the Christmas COVID edition because I was diagnosed with COVID on Wednesday and I feel utterly terrible. But I've been trying to get this pilot for a long time and couldn't let the opportunity go. So, hello, Miki. How are you doing?
Hello, buddy. Hello, ACG members. I'm doing very well. Yeah, thank you very much.
I don't think you've been, so you're down as flying for 501, but have you been flying that much? Because every time I try and get you, you said you were busy with this real life stuff. So have you actually had the chance to fly?
Yeah, I flew less and less this year due to some odd time in my life, private life, and regarding my job as well. So I must admit that ACG was not my priority number one this year. But no, I'm back, hopefully.
Back for 2021?
Yeah, back for the end of 2020 and hopefully for 2021, yeah.
Okay, so I want to try and not talk about ACG in this one. I want to do something a bit more interesting. I've heard a rumour that you're an ex-fighter pilot. So is that true? Who did you fly for and what aircraft did you fly?
Yeah, that's true. I've been a former military pilot, first jet aircraft fighter pilot, like we say, for 24 years now. I've been leaving French Air Force in 2019, and I began with French Air Force in 1996, so at the age of 21, and so for 24 years, yeah.
Did you sign up to go in as a fighter pilot then? Did you just decide? Was that always on the cards, or did you just one day go, you know what, I'm gonna try it?
You know, as far as I remember, I was always thinking about aircraft, aviation, and so on. So I began to fly as a private pilot first at the age of 16, learning glider and so on, and then getting my private pilot license. And on the other hand, I wanted to join the army or whatever military was. So yeah, I went for the Air Force, for the French Air Force, but not mainly for to fly a fast jet. I was mainly looking to fly, airlift aircraft, doing some mission in Africa and so on. But you know, at some point you don't have choice, and they told me to join a fighter jet. So yeah, it was not the plan initially, and I like it so much. If I've been asked now to choose again, I will go for fighter jet. Yeah, sure.
So did they say to you, Miki, you're too good for this, you need to be in fighters? Or was it, how did it come about? Did they have
no I can't say that. You know, you have to you have to get pilot where they need his. So yeah, the plan was to be transport pilots, you know, at some point I was as well thinking it was too complicated, too difficult for me to be a fighter pilot. So at some point, yeah, you think of something else. But at the end, when you are well trained, you can manage to do quite whatever you can. I mean, yes, training a lot, and at the end it works. Yeah.
Is it 7 days a week training, 12 hours a day, or how do they split it up? And where's the focus? Do you start off, obviously, on basic aircraft maneuvers and practicing, I guess, smaller jets, I guess you graduate to first, and then your aim is to get into something like a Mirage, or you tell me.
Yeah, so it was quite fast. I mean, I've been graduated as a fighter pilot in 2 years, yeah. And to end January, and I've been graduated in December 2 years after. So first part was about military things and so on, of course. And then about 1 year and a half learning flying on small piston-equipped aircraft, the TP-30 Epsilon. So a single propeller aircraft, a small one, but with 300 horsepower already. And then we were switching to the Alpha Jet, so kind of, if you wish, with two engines, so a small fighter jet, for 1 year. And then we were graduated as a fighter pilot. So job was done from Monday to Friday, in fact. We were flying quite all day, sometimes twice a day. And we were flying quite a lot at this time. And then after this graduation as fighter pilot, he has spent 6 more months on the Alpha Jet, learning how to fight in air combat mainly, doing some dogfight as a single aircraft and then as a pair.
Oh, so hold on, so you qualify as a fighter pilot, but then you learn how to dogfight?
Yeah, you are, in French Air Force, we are splitting, you need to first learn how to fly the jet, and then how to fight, knowing how to fly it, you know? But it's quite, I mean, everything is coming from time to time, so even before you are beginning to learn how to do it, but in terms of tactics and so on, you are really learning that after you have been graduated as a fighter pilot.
Which part of the training did you enjoy the most? I mean, was there like a session of the training with a certain jet or aircraft you thought, I really like that bit, but you obviously go on and you fly fast jets in the end, but do you have something that was a really high point during the training?
Yeah, I think my best flight will be, I mean, my first flight on a jet, when you are working to reach your aircraft a few meters ago, but you have time to think that you are flying this type of aircraft for the first time. It's so amazing. And when you take off, you don't understand anything because you are not so ground, but you are already at flight level 100, you know. Your mind need to think ahead, but you need time to do that. Everything is not so difficult at the end, but yeah, first flight on a jet is something very, very particular. And I think my best part during the training was about everything regarding tactics, you know, air to ground stuff, dropping some training grounds on shooting range, things like that was very, very, very nice to do.
Anything you found particularly challenging that took you a while to master?
In terms of training, you mean?
Yeah.
Dogfight with several aircraft is something very, very difficult, I guess. You know, in terms of safety, I mean, peacetime, you need to think about where is your leader, where are the other aircraft, not to enter a certain bubble and so on. So to keep the situation awareness of everything which is going on during the dogfight, trying to do your best as a student as well. It's something very challenging at first, yeah.
And did your classmates all graduate or did some of them drop off? Because I imagine it's pretty hard to qualify.
No, we were about 23, 25, I guess 20. So quite a huge number were qualified at the end. As fighter pilots, we were 5 graduated, and only one was sent to transport aircraft at the end of the course.
Oh, it's got to be a shit, hasn't it?
Yeah, that's it. But he was still flying, so at the end of the pilot, you want to be in that aircraft. But yeah, when you have, let's say, flew on those kind of aircraft, yeah, it's quite difficult to go on anything else, yeah.
And did they show you Top Gun at the start or anything and say to you guys, fellas, this is not how you'll be flying, so forget that from the start?
That's a strange question because, you know, they are very good mindset, in fact. You, when you are in the aircraft, when you are flying, it's very, very serious, you know, yeah. As soon as the canopy is closed. But on the other hand, I'm quite sure, but you may know it, spirit, when you are outside the scope of the course, outside of the scope of the training, as soon as this is the end of the day, in fact, everybody is getting a Top Gun spirit, you know, challenging each other. Going to the beer and so on. No, very nice spirit, very, very nice spirit. But it is not Top Gun. We are not King Sam Shaw with towel and so on. No.
And so, do you end up kind of addicted to fighter jets? Like, so you go from pistons, and the first time you take off in a jet must be, are you prepared, or is it like, whoa? You're still not ready for it because it's so powerful.
No, you are not ready at all. I mean, you can't be ready. So. I don't like to say it's something very special and so on. It is at some point, but I'm not telling you that this is very difficult. No, it is not. You don't. The difficulty, in fact, is in terms of time, the time for the training. If you quite everybody, as soon as you've got medical fitness and so on, quite a lot of people can do that. But in terms of training, it is so short that as soon as you are outside, losing some days because you have missed some flight and so on, it's very, very difficult to continue on that. So back on your question, first flight, you have about, I guess, five sessions of simulators before, and then your first flight, so with an instructor on the back. But even with that, even with five simulators, you cannot be ready for the first flight. I mean, you are, in fact, but your mind is still way back outside the aircraft, you know.
And does it always feel just pretty amazing to be in a fast jet? Because it's just something that very few people get to experience, right? And you're doing it as a job, and you're always flying at hundreds of miles an hour.
Yeah, this is, I think, the best point of all of that, to be able to do, to change your passion into a job. Whatever your passion is, as soon as you can work something which is your passion, this is something which is outstanding. I mean, so yeah, back to my passion, aviation, flying a fast jet for 24 years. Yeah, it's so, you know, at some point, even 24 years after, you can't believe that you are doing this job. In fact, that's amazing. I mean, you can't get used to that. You can't. Or board, or whatever you want. I mean, every flight are different. Yeah. Every aircraft I flew were different as well. The team you are working with is different as well. So yeah, a very, very nice job. Yeah, sure.
And what's the actual model that you're flying? I presume it's Dassault Mirage, but is it a specific type and variant that you fly? And what's your impressions of that aircraft in the air?
Yeah, I began to fly what we call the CPCAT, UK and France. Built aircraft. Yeah, the Jaguar was my first jet.
The Jaguar. You'll be popular with, I think Digby's got a soft spot for them. Digby or Speed, I can't remember which.
It was a very nice aircraft to fly because you were a pilot inside, you know. You had to first fly it. Very stable, very nice in air-to-ground missions. Yeah, very nice aircraft. The only thing was about engines. It was, they were awful at all. Yeah, we were lacking some power. So there's a huge difference between your Jaguar and ours, because the engine was still stuck with the first version of the engine, and we were lacking power at, quite a lot. But on the other hand, it was very nice aircraft. I really enjoyed to fly the Jaguar. I flew this aircraft for 3 years. And then after, I switched to a flight instructor job, flying the TB-30, so learning new student pilot how to fly an aircraft. It's working like that in French Air Force. You are moving from frontline squadrons to instructor at some point, and then you return to frontline squadron and so on.
Yeah, that's good, because it sort of keeps you on your toes in a way, right?
Yeah. Very
different
nice
experiences.
Sure.
Did you get any sort of frontline action anywhere? Have you got any sort of stories you could share of, you know, interesting or hot moments that you had whilst you were flying?
Yeah, I had some, yeah.
Probably not.
So in Jaguar, I flew in ex-Yugoslavia, but it was quite, let's say, peaceful at this time. It was after 1999, so we were only, let's say not only, but we are doing some reconnaissance mission, taking some picture of ground army warehouse and so on. Then I've changed to the Mirage 2000. It was a diversion, so flying with a weapon system officer on the back. And on this aircraft, I spent 7 years on this one, and I flew on different territory. I flew in Afghanistan, I flew in Libya.
Wow.
As well. So, yeah. So, I had some quite interesting moments, mainly in Afghanistan, because first, as a fighter pilot, you are seeing, let's say, those kind of things from 20,000 feet, and then you are inside this country, and you are receiving some rockets. That's interesting. Very interesting. And you know the atmosphere on the airbase with some Apache, some Chinook, and so on. The airbase is very, very busy. And
Is there camaraderie amongst different nations, or do you stick to your own nations?
Many you are stick to your nation, but you are joining other squadrons. I mean, as fighter pilots, you are part of a group. I mean, and we were, let's say, doing some kind of party with Dutch guy flying the F-16.
Oh, yeah.
And as well on the IR guys, they were on the opposite side of the base at Kandahar. But yeah, we had a good spirit with all of them. Yeah, sure.
And so, being sent to places like Afghanistan in the Mirage, do you feel it was a capable aircraft? Was there something you might have preferred to have had, like an F-16, or were you quite happy in the Mirage and you knew how to handle it, so therefore you didn't have any concerns?
No, you can. I mean, even if you're flying an F-16, you may think that there is something better than that. I don't know. It was a very inefficient aircraft. Main point was about ammunition we have, meaning that we didn't have any gun inside this version of the Mirage 2000. The air defense one got some cannons, but not this D version, you know. And we were lacking, we were only carrying two bombs. So we were starting from nothing. If you want to do something, we had nothing, two bombs. So we were lacking some guns at some point, yeah. But on the other hand, it was very efficient doing some, what we call the show for. So last call before doing something kinetic. The show of force is a low pass over at the enemy or whatever position is.
Yeah.
And Mirage 2000 can do it by every day, by night, with sandstorm and whatever you want. You can descend through very bad weather and you can overfly the position at very low level, very fast speed, about 540 knots. Using your token following radar.
And so going from the training jet to flying the actual fighter jet, do you have to be careful, because you can probably throw a trainer jet around a lot more in terms of G-loading than you can a fighter jet, even though you've got a G-suit? I mean, do you have to be mindful of that plane and how it performs and how it affects you?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you need to be very careful of that. It's something I was very... My health. You need to think about yourself. You need to think if you are tired and so on. And you need to advise other crew members or other guys in the flight if you feel tired. So yeah, G load on Mirage 2000 was 9G. You need to be prepared for that. Yeah, sure.
And if you can, without giving anything away, can you sort of take me through any sort of potential engagements? So say you get lit up by a SAM or something. What's the process that you go through in the cockpit to handle that situation? Do you pause and say, right, let's identify the threat, let's call it out to people? Like, how do you go through the motion without, you know, revealing military secrets around that?
Yeah, no, you have to be trained in order to react, because you don't have time to think about what you need to do.
Yeah.
You need to react to it. So mainly that's what we call the memory items, you know, you need to go through it. Don't remember feeling fear about it. Or when you are facing those kind of situation, you know, you are reacting to it.
Quite clinical, right?
Yeah, that's it. Then after, when the situation is quite, let's say, cooler, you know, you begin to think about what happened. But at the time, you are not thinking about it. You are doing your job and you are well trained to do that. So, yeah.
And when you come down, does it hit you afterwards? Sometimes if you've been in a hot one, do you start to get the shakes later on that you suddenly process what went on, or you never got into that kind of risky situation that much?
No, depending on the guys, you know, you are not prepared for that, I guess. You can't be prepared for that. So depending of your... not your mindset, but from a guy to another, they will react differently. So yeah, I've got some very, let's say, good memories. I've got some memories and I'm thinking about things. But on the other hand, I'm happy with what I've done, what I've been doing and so on. some other friends of mine, they face very hard time thinking back about particular cases, and they suffer about it. Yeah.
This is one of those ones where I need to get you in a pub and play with drink to come out with the stories. But when it comes to flying simulations on the PC, how does that feel having been in a fighter jet? Because even in the military, you'd have been in a hydraulic simulator, so you would have felt some emulation of G-forces and climbing and descending, but you don't get that sat behind a PC. So how does that feel to you? Does it feel very sort of compartmentalized? You go, oh, this is just a game. It's not like it was then. That's fine. I'm just doing it for fun. How do you handle it?
Yeah, your point about G-load is something. Yeah, so the main difference is this point. You know, the physical you don't get in sim.
Yeah. Does that feel weird in your head because your brain's programmed to experience G-loads, right, and predict stuff?
Yeah, no, not so much. I mean, I'm facing a screen and a PC, so yeah. Not so much. But when you compare what you are doing on a sim, I mean, talking about pilots, your virtual pilots and a real one, you will be exhausted after that.
Yes.
And you may face some jetlag. So yeah, this is the main difference. On the other hand, we've got now, and for years now, we've got some very, very nice tools on the PC, and we are very close, in fact, in terms of mindset, in terms of managing, specific situations. It's very, very, it's something very, very close to the real world, more and more, yeah.
And so the option of you flying props World War II, is that because you don't care about sort of reliving the jet fighting? You want the camaraderie and the experience of flying as a unit in props, which is very different to what your real world life was. Is that what drives you to, you know, fly an ACG in the past and going forward, or what is it that motivates you?
So first, I'm flying some sim, flying jet and so on. Back on World War II prop, I mean, aviation for me is something very, it's a passion. I mean, I've been through historical things when I was young. I was living in Brittany, so in south part of Brittany, near Lorient and Saint-Nazaire, with the U-boat bases and so on. So during World War II, they have seen some multiple B-17 coming here to drop bombs on these U-boat bases and so on. I spent my young time in Van Airfield. This was the Jagdgeschwader 2 air base with aces like Egon Meyer and so on. So I spent years and years on this type of airport and so on. And I've been very interested in this local history, you know. So for me, World War II aircraft is as well something I'm very interested in. So, yeah, I've been looking for big squadron, a big team, in order to being able to recreate this kind of atmosphere. I'm not looking to fly World War II aircraft. I'm looking to fly it or them inside a team which is
exactly
able to do what was going on, you know, to replicate what was going on 60 or 70 years ago now.
And so how different do you find it? Because you'd think you would take the Germans by storm because you're a jet fighter pilot, so it would be a piece of piss for you, but clearly it doesn't translate that way. And I saw a thing,
no.
I can't remember if it was Tactical Pascal or I was watching a video some time ago, and he said, you know, it's a very, you know, people that are good at sims, it's a very different thing to flying a real jet, and they wouldn't get away with it. And vice versa, right? Real jet pilots have to adjust to sims.
Yeah, sure. I think the main thing is about you are lacking situational awareness. You are not inside a real aircraft, so you cannot take real life and put it into your PC. It won't work like that. I mean, on the other hand, what is very interesting in air combat group when you are facing, let's say, a 10-to-10 dogfight, 10 guys against 10 guys, or maybe more, you can see some very efficient guys knowing their job, or let's say their job, knowing how to handle their Messerschmitt or whatever they are flying. And you've got a panel, in fact, of guys. You've got some very good guys flying the aircraft. You see some newbie, many, or guys learning how to fly. And you can find, like in real life, in fact, some very good guys. You know when you are dogfighting those guys, it will be a hard time. And on the other hand, so at some point, you can just dive and kill someone, you know. Virtually kill, of course.
And have you tried things like the Mirage in DCS as a comparison to the real thing? Does DCS look any good compared to what your experience of fighter jets is? Or have you not done that?
Yeah, I've been flying the Mirage 2000 in DCS. It's a very, very good aircraft.
You enjoy it, right?
Yeah, I enjoy it. We've got details that are not like the same aircraft because they didn't have all the documentation to create this aircraft. And now French Air Force is using this Mirage 2000 to train pilots as well. They're creating a link with RASBAM, which is doing the Mirage 2000, in order to improve the aircraft and to have an aircraft, the Mirage 2000, which is actually very close to the real one, in fact, to train a low-cost simulator, if you want. So very nice, very nice aircraft to fly. But at some point, as you know the aircraft, you spot differences, and that should be, let's say, something that you will say, no, it's not working as that, you know. On the other hand, if you are not knowing well the aircraft, like I'm flying a lot the F-18 or the F-14, you are not spotting those kind of things. So yeah, I prefer mainly to fly other aircraft.
So going back to things about G-loading, I wanted to get your impression of that, because in Box, Jason and his fellas and ladies have implemented G-loading. And do you feel that it's done in a fair fashion? Does it feel right to you? Or do you feel, some people complain, right? People complain whichever way it goes. But in your perspective and your experience, does it seem right?
Quite. But the thing is that you need to, listen to the sound in order to know that you are reaching a G-log, for example, and so on. Your body is not reacting to that. It's quite something you will not be able to simulate that. But when an aircraft, you know that you are reaching this limit, hopefully, you can't have that on the sim. So many you will be facing a J-lock, not knowing that you will reach this point in a sim. I don't know if we can do it better. This is very good depiction. The only thing is that you can't feel your body. So things are happening and you are facing it. You cannot anticipate the fact that you are losing consciousness.
And is there any aircraft in the world ever that you never got to fly, clearly a lot, that you would really like to have had the chance if somebody wheeled it out and said, here you are, Miki, you can take this for the day and give it a spin from any era, anything?
Oh, I will go for a World War II fighter, sure.
Yeah. Which one?
Oh, you know, we've got some twin-seat Hurricane now. So maybe if I've got money, I will try to have a flight on a Hurricane, yeah. And of course, your beautiful Spitfire, yeah, sure.
Oh, don't start me on the Spitfire. So I was going to ask people before this interview, because, you know, it's fantastic to have someone who's an actual ex-fighter pilot. You are ex-fighter pilot, right? You've retired. You're not still flying the jets.
No. Right now, I'm stuck on the ground. I was going to join an airline soon after the Air Force. I was trained on the Airbus 320, and COVID things in March ended my history. So I need to change, and now I'm teaching young pilots how to fly. Theoretical things about how to fly an airliner.
Yeah, so I was going to ask people for submitting questions, but I thought it would be an absolute avalanche of questions, and we'd be here for like hours on end or days, because I'm sure a lot of people have got things they'd like to ask you, and I've probably not even covered a fraction of them. But what was interesting was I saw Fast Jet Performance, and he was saying about the last day that he flew his jet. How did that feel to you, the last flight you took? Was it tinged with sadness? Because Fast Jet Performance said, well, he kind of prepped himself and said, well, that's it, I'm done. Did it feel like that to you on your last flight, or did you feel very anxious about, you know, getting in the cockpit, starting her up, flying her around, and then bringing her back down.
This is a fan which is very, very particular, more than a solo flight, your first solo, I guess. This is the end of something. You know that you will never fly those kind of aircraft again.
They cost $30 million as well, I think, or 30 million sterling, those French Mirages.
I don't even know, you know. I didn't look at that, you know.
Just give me the plane, I'll fly it.
Yes, that's
it. So how did it feel to do that last flight?
You know, I was not happy, but I was happy to leave the French Air Force. Happy is not a real word. How can I say that? I spent so many nice years, you know. I've been through 24 years. Everything was not perfect, but close, very close. I enjoy every day, every years, every flight. And so I knew at this time, I cannot get more than what I had. So it was a nice hand, you know? I was very feeling, relaxed about leaving the French Air Force and happy. So regarding the last flight, this is your last flight. The last time you start the aircraft, you take off the aircraft, the last time you land it, then you turn off the engine. Yes, it's something very, very strange. And
emotional, really
emotional, but at the end, you know, now I'm out of French Air Force for a little bit more than 1 year. I don't feel angry, or I've made a choice, and regarding back my 24 years in French Air Force, I'm very, very happy of what I've done. So yeah, that helped me in order to not looking back, you know.
Yeah, that's great. Absolutely, thank you for your time, Miki, because it's been a long time coming, and I really wanted to get hold of you because it's there's just so much more we could probably talk about, but we just don't really have the time to do it, sadly. And one thing I did want to ask is, have you ever thought about doing a dogfighting masterclass for ACG?
Sorry, no. I can't do that. You know, so good. You know, I need to learn from some guys here. You know,
it's all about the humility, right?
Sorry,
it's all about the humility.
No. Guys are very good, very, very good. Knowing how to manage the engines, the aircraft. Getting the situation awareness in front of the screen, you know, this is something very specific, and they are very, very nice top ace in ACG. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so thanks very much for doing this and taking the time, because I know you're busy and it's not been easy. And I hope everyone's enjoyed listening to you talk, because I thought it was fascinating.
Thank you, Paddy. Thank you very much.
Thank
and,
you,
Miki. I can answer another question if you want. No problem at all. Yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers, Paddy. Cheers, ACG.